give us free. Give us free. Give us free.
Your Honor, please instruct the defendant that he cannot disrupt these proceedings with such alcohol.
Give us free!
If we are to have any semblance of awareness,
give us
Mod Hotel, and welcome my conscious and unconscious family and peeps. This is the African Village Community Podcast, and I am truly your host of the show, JC, aka Afro Black, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut. Without any fear, as I use my mic as a spear to chucka chucka your wit liberated truth, I am your host and African soldier in the struggle. My purpose and mission for this show is first to inform, enlighten, and engage. And you all know what I mean by engage. I want to engage with all those who claim they know the truth. All truth seekers and conscious family, I welcome you. This show is dedicated to all our ancient ancestors and to all those who have carried the mantle of truth. To every person with the ability to throw off the chains of comfortable habit and unwarranted assumption and move in a new, liberated direction that is guided by truth and observational evidence. No matter where that direction may lead you, my main objective and purpose here is freedom, mind, soul, and spirit. That being said, welcome to the African Village Community Podcast and much love from our great universal African goddess and mother of all, living here and above, Ashe and Ashe.
AC in the house.
See, now, as long as they kill us and go to Wendy's and have a burger and go to sleep, they're going to keep killing us. But when we die and they die, then soon we're going to sit at a table and talk about retirement. We want some of this earth, or we'll tear this goddamn country up.
Black mask, black gloves, in the black car, the black Glock, taking every shot like a black mama, black Moses. Freedom comes over a band of black roses. The revolution starts the day after the trap closes. Black genius genetically in that black semen. My reparation is aiming into we back even. Black Jesus, fear the black penis. May God bless you if you hearing that cat sneezing. I'm George Jackson, 5 stars and 4 magnums, 3 eyes and 2 cannons, 1 shot, then you vanish. Long got that your noodle, now Waka Flocka. I'm Shaka Zulu, Bishop Desmond Tutu with the clip in, ready to shoot you, black voodoo. Fannie Lou Hamer, presumed danger. I return like the pharaohs that curse these tomb raiders. Black as the true savior, 2 razors for you haters. Black Moors taking Jerusalem from the crusaders. X.
Strike back,
hey, hey, hey. This is JC, a.k.a. Afro Black, and I am here with you for another delicious Black Sunday, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut. You heard me here at the Black Village Community Podcast, and I am here, and I am back, and I am Black, and I am happy to be back. I've been gone for almost a month due to a residential change, and, it took time. It was an uncomfortable move, but it is definitely a comfortable, once I got here and once I got everything distributed everywhere and put up and everything, got my studio put back together, now it's nice and comfortable. I have to admit, I am very comfortable in my new place. But, I was a little disappointed because it took me away from my podcast. It took me away from my conscious family for a minute. But I am back and I am Black and I am ready to drop the raw and uncut and share and communicate and verbrate and all that with my conscious family here on the Black Village. You can join me. It doesn't cost you a dime, just a bit of your conscious time. Here at the Black Village Community Podcast, you can chime in at 857-232-0155. Or you can also chime in at 855-445-9340. And don't forget the conference code to get through the conference dough to sit at the conference table of truth with me, which is 947595. And so today's podcast subject is a very good subject matter and a very important subject matter and a very controversial subject matter, which is titled A Conscious Soldier for His People or a Delusional Miseducated Killer as the Media Wants Us to Accept. Again, A Conscious Soldier for His People or a Delusional Miseducated Killer as the Media Wants Us to Accept. And so let me change my theme music, as I love freedom, 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 freedom for all, freedom for us, Black Power, you feel me? And let me play something more laid back. Yeah, something like this here. Oh yeah, Pump Your Black Fist is what I'm talking about, you feel me? And so my queen is not here with me, and she wanted to be here very much, but she had to go out there and, clock them dollars and cents, you feel me, for her family. So, but I'm here, JC, a.k.a. Afro Black, here. And so we're going to talk about today. I want to share with the community that is really dear to my heart, we lost two brothers. We've lost more than two brothers, but I'm talking about these two specific brothers due to what they, what caused us to lose them. We lost two conscious soldiers, as I'm going to call these brothers, you feel me? And that is Gavin Eugene Long and Micah Xavier Johnson. And, we lost these brothers due to, their actions, which was in reference to what's been going on here in the United States across the country. Killer cops, serial killer cops, as I will call them, who have been executing, murdering, assassinating unarmed Black women and children across the U.S. Okay, and so what I'm not sure if most people know or not, but these brothers who decided to take the law in their own hands to protect their people, at least to a degree of sending a strong message to the white so-called law enforcement community, these brothers were military. Gavin Long was a Marine. Micah Johnson also, I believe, he was a brother from the Army. Both of these brothers fought for this country. And both of these brothers, if they had not done what they'd done to send the message to the law enforcement community, if they had just did what most have done already to no avail, protest, debate, with these ignorant white folks and these dumbfounded house Negroes who justify what police officers have done, they saw things going nowhere
on that level. You feel me? And so these brothers decided that they wanted to send a strong message, in my opinion. This is what their purpose were. This is the reason why they did what they did, to send a strong message to the white community, to law enforcement, that they were tired. They were sick and tired of the bloodshed. And so I noticed that a brother just chimed in. My brother, I believe is my brother from 916. You got something you want to say before I go into playing some audio cast, my brother? Or you want to wait until after the audio cast before, you know, before we reverberate on this? Go ahead.
After the audio cast.
Okay. So let me play. I got an audio cast I want to play that's going to stimulate conversation. Hopefully, it's going to stimulate also some people's minds out there who are confused about what has happened and what has trespassed over the past weeks with Brother Xavier Johnson, and also Brother Gavin Eugene Long, who decided to send a message to the law enforcement community. And you know what? The media has lied, misrepresented, as well as misinterpreted these brothers' actions. And I believe that's done for a reason, because white people are not ignorant. White devils are not stupid. They know why these brothers have done what they did. They just don't want to say it. They don't want to talk about it. They don't want to verberate on it. So let me play a brother who will verberate on this. Let me play a brother who has a name in the academic community, a brother who travels, who speaks, who lectures, and who writes, and who's an author. And that's Dr. Boyce Watkins. Again, this brother is Dr. Boyce Watkins. Very educated, very intellectual brother. Brother who's active in the community, active across the country, giving lectures, teaching, sharing. And so let me play this brother, and we shall take it from there.
Good morning, everybody. How you doing? I'm Dr. Boyce Watkins from Your Black World, and I'm in Los Angeles right now. I'm working on a movie project, and of course, like everybody else, like the rest of the world, I've been following all this stuff that's been happening out in Dallas and across the country as it pertains to the police killings of black men, as well as the unfortunate tragedy that took place with the brother Micah Xavier Johnson, who took the law in his own hands. You know, he seemed like a young brother who felt that the police were not serving and protecting his community, and so he felt compelled to serve and protect his community on his own. Let's talk about this brother, Micah Johnson. I'm not going to condemn this black man. I'm not going to do it. I don't care what not. You know, I don't know how anybody else feels. I don't know what I'm supposed to say. I don't know if I'm supposed to say, well, you know, we don't condone violence, and violence is never the answer. And this man was a monster. I'm not going to say all of that. I'm going to say he was a pissed off brother. I'm going to say that he reminds me a little bit of myself at the age of 25. Not that I actually would have done what he did, because it takes a lot of guts to fight back like that. But I can tell you what. Everybody that knows this man, everybody that knows this brother, everybody that knew him, all his neighbors said he was a good person. He was a good kid. He cared about his community. So think about this. Now, when he was ready to kill for the United States government, when he was ready to go kill and pull that weapon out to go kill on behalf of the United States government and to serve his country, y'all were cool with that. That was fine. He was a hero at that point. But when he was ready to kill to serve and protect his community, you suddenly call him a lunatic. Right? Now, maybe to in your mind, maybe to you, he is a lunatic. I mean, shoot, if I'm a cop, yeah, absolutely I'm gonna be a scared of this guy. Okay. But you can't sort of hula hoop your way out of the logic that clearly states that he is a hero when he's killing for you. But he becomes the villain when he's killing for us. This brother did this for us. When he was out there with the gun, he was like, I'm tired of y'all killing my people. an eye for an eye. I look straight up like this. He never would have done that if so many black men had not been killed. So why is that any different from a soldier who's out in Iraq somewhere who goes and kills because you kill some of his fellow soldiers? Because when you kill another young black man, to a lot of other young black men, you killing a fellow soldier. This man was the same age. When Micah got killed, he was the same age that Tupac Shakur was when he died. The exact same age, 25 years old. And I remember 25 is an interesting age. That's exactly when I started getting pissed off. And I started doing things in response to my environment. That's when I started feeling angry. Like, how are they going to treat us like this? How are they doing this to us? This is crazy to me. So I know that age of 25. I know something about how he felt. I would not be surprised if there was a connection. I wouldn't be surprised if I met him and he said, you know, Dr. Boyce, like all the other brothers I see around the country. Like, I see so many brothers around the country who are like, Dr. Boyce, thank you for teaching us. You know, I love you, Dr. Boyce. So, and I bet you anything that if I had talked to this brother, we would have had that same conversation. I bet you he would know a lot about some of the things that we talk about here. And so I'm not on any level ever going to condemn him in the way I would if I was some white man on TV. I'm not going to do that. Now, am I going to say that we should all pick up guns and go start killing people? I don't think that's the answer right now. I don't think that's the answer at any point. But I do think that what can be done is those of you, the mainstream Negroes, Negroes with jobs, you can point to that and say, you see what will happen if you continue to mess with these young black men. We can help you. We can talk them down. But if you don't change your behavior, then we can't talk them down. You know, like just like Martin and Malcolm could work with each other. Martin could say, look, hey, the Black Panthers are out here. Malcolm X is out here. And I can try to talk them down. But if you don't change your behavior, then we're going to have a problem. So you better deal with me or you're going to have to deal with that. And you don't want to keep dealing with that because everybody's going to lose if you deal with that.
There you go. That's Dr. Boyce Watkins dropping the raw and uncut. He told you the brother laid his life down for his fellow black brother. This brother, Micah Xavier Johnson, regardless of what the white community say, regardless of how the white community feels, regardless of what law enforcement want to portray these brothers and try to assassinate these brothers' characters because they are no different than an organized mafia. They're no different than an organized mafia. Just like the mafia evolved over the years in this country and got their hands in some of everything. Law enforcement has evolved and got their hands in some of everything, and that everything is not positive. It is definitely positively negative. And they want to assassinate these brothers' characters because these brothers, like he said, when they're over there, because both of these brothers, Micah Xavier Johnson, just as well as Galvin Eugene Long, they both were military. And to be specific and to be a little detailed, Brother Galvin Long, that brother was a decorated Marine. He had 2 medals for fighting in Iraq and I believe also in Afghanistan. He did more than 1 tour. I believe he did 2 tours, if not more. And he was a sergeant. He was not a private. He was a sergeant. He gave orders. You feel me? And the brother laid his life down for his people. Now, I'm not sure about Micah Xavier Johnson, but I know this much about Galvin Long. His internet name was Cosmo, and he did YouTube videos to motivate his people. And I got a little bit of that I want to play as well. I plan on playing a little bit of that if I can squeeze that in as well, because that brother left a message with the conscious community. He was conscious. Galvin Eugene Long was a conscious brother. He was a conscious soldier. Now you got these white devils and these black devils, house Negroes, okay, who don't give a damn about their people, will say anything, will jump, sit, bark, whatever the white devil tell them to do, they'll do, especially for that green cotton, and who will say that these brothers were criminals, will say these brothers had, they were delusional. But I ask you, conscious community, What do you say? You be the judge. These were our people. You feel me? These were our people who laid their lives down for us. So Dr. Boyce, an educated intellectual brother who has enough dignity, enough love and loyalty to his people to realize what these brothers did and why they did it. And he said it. He said it. As long as them brothers were over there fighting the war for America, they were considered heroes when they came back. But when they came back, did they feel like heroes? Did they really feel like heroes? When they came back, seeing black people across the country being gunned down by police officers who are doing, and no accountability, no accountability. Nobody, you know, nobody's really going to jail. You might see one here, one there, and then they want everybody to throw their hands up because one gets sent to jail. But you got one, you got a penny thrown in the bucket. Just a penny thrown in the bucket, and you can hear the penny moving around in the bucket when you got a whole bunch of disfigured, corrupted, messed up pennies that need to be all thrown in the bucket. And then you got across this country where debates are going on and conversations are going on in media, you know, and at the same time, still you see white people who are numb to what's happening. If it was happening to their community, if black cops was killing white kids, white men and white children and white women in the name of the law, you will see a different side to these white folks. But instead, you hear them making excuses for law enforcement. And I'm going to tell you why. The reason why is because a lot of these white people have relationships, relatives, friends, neighbors who are a part of these corrupted police departments, who put on the blue and the badge every day with a biased attitude and a racist mindset towards the black community. And those who are not racist, they're biased. Why they're biased? Because they put on a uniform and the badge in fear. In fear. In fear of what? In fear of what they've been told by their white neighbors. In fear of what they've been told by their white friends and white relatives, which in a sense is still white supremacy at its finest, because now you are wearing a badge and can't do your job respectively or correctively due to the fact that now you're going to treat the next black woman, black man, not the same, not with equal justice, not with fairity, not with the same quality of professionalism as you would treat a blonde-haired, blue-eyed, white woman and white man. So, on that note, Brother Carrington, since you're here with me at the Conscious Table of Truth, you got anything to say about what I just said and about what you just heard Dr. Watkins provide us with?
Yes, I have a question for you. What do they call a person who is put to death or endures great suffering on behalf of any belief, principle, or cause? What do you call that person?
A martyr.
That's what these two brothers are.
I would have to agree with you, my brother. They are. They're martyrs. They should be honored. They should be respected. Their story should be told. We should share it with our children. I don't expect white people to do what we do. I don't celebrate Christmas. I don't celebrate Independence Day. I don't celebrate Memorial Day, because these are white holidays. These are white celebrations. And I, you know what? I don't put a white person down for celebrating their festivities. And neither should the black community be put down for celebrating their festivities, meaning we honor our fallen soldiers like Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. What cracked me up is you got white folks celebrating Martin Luther King all day long, but they also misrepresent Martin Luther King. They give a falsified image of Martin Luther King. They give the image that they want us to accept and they want us to see. They don't tell you that Martin Luther King was becoming more and more militant before he was assassinated. They don't tell you that Martin Luther King agreed with those who were conscious soldiers and was willing to lay their life down and put their life on the line for their fellow brother. That he had no problem with a soldier who protected his people, protected his family, protected his community when necessary, as long as it was done in a proper fashion, meaning that you are doing something to protect, you're doing something about something that's being done to you out of the means of protecting your family, not just go, just not not just being not being a vigilante. But protecting your family from the enemy. So Martin Luther King had no problem with that. Okay? And they don't tell you that Martin Luther King was not necessarily nonviolent, but what he did and why he did it had a methodology behind it. It was called passive resistance. Passive resistance. That's what he did in the essence of making the dog look like the dog that it is, because the wolf is hiding in sheep's clothing. So now we got to expose the wolf. So how are we going to do this? We're going to all go out here. We're going to march. We're going to protest. And we're finna go where they don't want us to go. We finna go march in the community where we're not accepted. We finna go march in front of the store where we know the store owner is a white supremacist, and we know he's a white supremacist and he's hiding. So we're gonna go over here and do this. And this is, and so we know we're gonna get rocks thrown at us. We know we're gonna be spit at and called names. We might even be shot at. But you know what? We're gonna have the media is gonna be out there. I'm gonna make sure the media is out there, make sure reporters are out there. I'm gonna make sure this stuff is seen so people will know what's going on. It's called passive resistance. He had a methodology behind what he did. But what do these white devils do? They want people to believe, and they portray Martin Luther King in books, on TV, in reports, through the media, in the library, as a man who was literally nonviolent, as if he was Gandhi. Mind you, I want you to know that Martin Luther King did know Gandhi, and he did respect Gandhi, but he also understood Gandhi's philosophy and method. And Martin Luther King was no Gandhi, believe me. But he understood what Gandhi was doing. And as I said, Martin Luther King had a methodology behind what he was doing. He understood that the black man could not outgun the white man. He knew that the white man had more weapons. So he said, "Let's make we know the white man cares about how he looked to other white folks. We know the white man cares about how he looked to the entire international world. So let's make him look like the barbaric devil that he is." And that's what Martin Luther King did. But they want to portray this other, you know, this other ideology that Martin Luther King was Jesus, you know, turn the other cheek, you know, and that's a lie. So, but you're right, my brother. These brothers are martyrs. These brothers should always be remembered, regardless of what the white devil is going to try to do, because he got enough house niggas out there to do it for him, you know. And we need to expose, in my opinion, we should be exposing these house Negroes for who they are. I've had somebody not recently try to tell me that we, you know, black people need to stop going against black people. If we want unity, we got to stop tearing each other down. And we should stop tearing each other down. But in the process of not tearing each other down, that has nothing to do with the fact that us being a people of truth and integrity. And to be a people of truth and integrity built on principles and values, black principles and values, we have to expose a lie. If we're going to call the white devil a lie, because he's a liar with evidence and proof and a history and a resume to prove it, we cannot do that and still accept lies and misrepresentation from our own people. We have to expose these house Negroes for what they are. And these house Negroes are the ones that has always tore down our leaders. These house Negroes were the ones that was being used by the white devil to destroy organizations like the Black Panther Party. And many other. Even Marcus Garvey's organization was brought down by a house Negro. Some bringing it down from the inside out, not from the outside in. It was done from the inside out. They always got a good old house Negro, a good old coon, a good old porch monkey that can come in and pose and disguise himself as if he or she is conscious, and the whole time they have an agenda, and that agenda is a white agenda. So on that note, let me play this other, the second part of Dr. Boyce Watkins dropping the raw and uncut. So let me play this, and we will continue to verbrate.
What's interesting to me about a lot of this is that, you know, you saw just one month ago, you saw a story in the media where all the white America lost their damn mind because a gorilla got shot in a zoo. They went crazy. You would have really thought this gorilla was the president of the United States the way people acted out when this gorilla got shot. Black men are getting shot every single day. Right before the day before Alton Sterling was killed, I talked about another brother up in New York who was killed by a cop in a road rage incident. Happens every day all the time. And you really don't see any outrage from the collective of white America. You don't see that at all. And so while I certainly have seen examples, though, of white people who stand with us, I don't see the masses of white people standing with us. I don't see white institutions standing with us. I see us in a situation where sometimes for some of us, they feel like all we got is Michael Johnson. All we got is somebody that's willing to go out here and fight on behalf of us. And it's not, I mean, don't act like, you know, when you talk about America, don't act like y'all don't understand violence. Don't act like y'all don't understand retaliation. America is one of the most violent countries in the world. That's why, you know, and Minister Farrakhan brought this up when we had a conversation a couple years ago. We have more guns in this country than people. We have more guns than people in this country, especially in a place like Texas. In Texas, everybody got a gun. Little kids got guns. You know, and so don't act like you don't understand this violence. I just don't want it to continue. I don't think violence is a fun thing for anybody to endure. But understand this, like Minister Farrakhan talks about, it's about sometimes you got to distribute the pain a little bit. Sometimes other people got to know what you're going through. You know, I mean, do you know how many mothers have called me or emailed me and said they've been crying all day after seeing Alton Sterling murdered in cold blood on TV? Do you know how many mothers were telling me they were crying after seeing Alton, the brother Philando Castile get shot and killed in front of his girlfriend? The other brother in New York, his last name was Smalls, he was shot and killed in front of his children. His children, his girlfriend, and he didn't have a weapon. It was a road rage incident. The cop was mad because he didn't like his driving. That's what happened in New York. So, you know, the pain that other people might feel from what they just had to witness is a pain that black people deal with every day. It's something that mothers are dealing with every day on the south side of Chicago, where the police and politicians allow weapons into these neighborhoods that have no business being there. And don't pretend like you can't control it, because you don't let those weapons into the north side of Chicago where the rich white people live. You go to the north side of Chicago where rich white people live, it's like fucking Disneyland. It's clean, it's beautiful, it's safe, it's prosperous. You go to the south side of Chicago, some pockets, not the whole south side, but some pockets of it, clearly show the symptoms of an abandoned and neglected community. And when you got little 12, 13-year-olds running around with assault weapons, it's because some grown-up allowed this thing to happen. When they got cocaine in their pocket, they ain't going that cocaine down in the hood. That cocaine is coming from people outside of that community. So ultimately, a lot of even the black-on-black crime, which I do believe black-on-black crime is real. I believe it exists. I don't like that conversation where we got to somehow act like it's not real in order to make our point. I think we can acknowledge the reality of black-on-black crime while also acknowledging the reality of white supremacy and its role in the creation of black-on-black crime. That's where it comes from. White supremacy creates all of this nonsense. It's ridiculous.
Again, Boyce Watkins dropping the raw and uncut. As he said, he's basically saying that what we call the ghetto, the atmosphere of the ghetto, the makeup of the ghetto, is a construct that was created. And he's saying it's basically created by white supremacy. And I totally agree with him. Black folks don't have any factories that are manufacturing Smith & Wesson's, 9mm Glocks, 4.4s. Huh? No, I don't know any black person that owns any gun manufacturing company. Matter of fact, I believe the movie that I saw a long time ago called Nicolas Cage was in it. It was called, what was this movie called? I think was it called War? I think it was called War, Lords of War. And basically he was a gun dealer. He was underground. Somebody in the backdrop right here. He was an underground gun dealer who traded guns internationally, weapons internationally. And that's a white man. These are white folks who do this. White people trust white people. They don't trust us, and we don't trust them for good reason. You feel me? But he basically is saying, Dr. Walkins is saying, is that when you go into a white neighborhood, that is a construct that was created for white people so that white people can be comfortable, not just feel comfortable, literally be comfortable. You say you go into the other side of Chicago and it looks like Disneyland. Go on the other side of Chicago where black folks live and it looks like you're going into the Twilight Zone. And then they want to say, we've done this to our community. No, they do this to our community. They don't want the community to be clean. They don't care if the community looks like garbage because they don't have to drive through it if they don't want to. They don't give a damn if we have jobs or if we have our own businesses. And if anybody know anything about the history of Black Wall Street, that's proof in itself that they don't want us having anything on a unified level. See, this is the reason why they make sure all the black people who do have money are porch monkeys. Like Oprah Winfrey. Mm-hmm. Like Oprah Winfrey. She's like Bill Cosby. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. They make sure that our athletes are doing their job more than just on the court and on the field. But since you living right next door to me, Kobe, don't you be out there protesting. Huh? How they do this? They make sure they all up in Kobe Bryant's Kool-Aid. Believe me, he makes sure he got Kobe Bryant got them white folks coming to dinner meetings at his house, and you know, because they knew him before he retired. Now after he retired, they still want to know Kobe. To make sure Kobe is not influential in any constructive, positive way to the black community. They threaten their jobs. They threaten their income. They threaten their place of stay. But see, black folks have to be unified. We have to have more love for one another. Like Dr. Boyce says, I'm not contributing to any violence. I don't believe anybody should be hurt or killed, white or black. But at the same time, when it comes down to the rubber meeting the rubber, when it comes down to it, we as a black people have to love one another and love our communities. And that means when you love one another and love your communities and you love your mother, you love your brother, you love your sister, when you love your black people, you're willing to lay your life down for your people, at least those who are the soldiers. And I'm not going to say everybody is a soldier. To say everybody is a soldier is like to say everybody's a teacher. To say everybody's a teacher is to say everybody is a doctor. No, everybody have their place and their position in the community. And I say community, I'm talking about the black conscious community. Okay? But let me see if my brother right here, anything you want to say, my brother? You know, you heard that second piece there. Brother Currington? Okay, looked like he took a leave of absence, but yet he's still connected. So let me say let me read something right quick as well, because what I found, like I said, even the brothers who who've caused black people to start to rise up and to protest again, like the brother Philando Castile. I mean, I don't hear the media talking about how this brother, you know, they want to, you know, they crack me up. I noticed the media look for things that they can blow up and explode to assassinate one's character. Okay, now everybody know that brother Philando Castile was an elementary school cafeteria worker. Okay, everybody know that. But did you know that he was a straight A student in high school? He was a straight A student in high school and had no criminal record. Okay, he did have a concealed carry permit weapon. Okay, he had, in other words, he had a license to carry a gun. That still doesn't give the officer the right to shoot the brother. But you know what? I'm gonna tell you what I saw in that. Just like I saw the brother with Alton Sterling. Okay. Now, you know, you got people, the media running around saying that Alton Sterling pulled out a gun and that's why the officers shot him. That's another lie. I got an article I'm going to read on that. But this article that I'm reading right here about Brother Philando Castile, okay, which is called freethoughtproject.com. You can go check that out at freethoughtproject.com. Okay. This man was a good man. Okay. He was a he was in high school. He was a straight A student. Okay. Yes, he did have. Let me read this. Says this. Philando's cousin Antonio Johnson, 31, told the Star Tribune that Philando was an honor student at St. Paul Central High School, where he was a straight A student. On Facebook live video posted, Reynolds, she can be heard saying that Castillo worked for St. Paul school system and he's not affiliated with any gangs, that he has no criminal record. She was saying this, okay. Also, part three, it says that he had a permit to carry a gun, okay. Then he said, they killed my son. They took a good man, hard-working man. He worked since he was 18 years old. You think these white devils care? No, they didn't care. Where's the NRA, huh? Where's the National Rifle Association, huh? Who says that they stand up for the rights of those that carry guns, who has the right to carry. This brother had a permit, a license to carry. He didn't pull the gun out on the popo. He let the popo know he had a license to carry. He was reaching for his wallet when this white devil shot him. Uh-huh. And you know what? Matter of fact, the governor of Minnesota, where the brother was shot at, he was even shocked. Let me let you hear what this white man had to say. Now, not every white man is a devil, but you know what? There's a whole lot of them that keep their mouth quiet to make themselves look like devils. You feel me? So when the ones that do stand up and speak out, they stand out like a sore thumb. And I'm pretty sure it makes all them white devils mad when a fellow white brother says something against their devilish asses. So let me let you hear what this governor of Minnesota had to say about the police shooting of Philando Castile. Hold on right here.
Terrible tragedy has befallen the people of Minnesota, especially the family and friends of Philando Castile. And I express, on behalf of all decent-minded Minnesotans, which is just about everyone, our deepest condolences, our shock and our horror at what transpired last night. All the facts aren't known, but from the evidence that's been presented, the video that was taken, nobody should be shot and killed in Minnesota for a traffic taillight being out of function. Nobody should be shot and killed while their seat is still in their car without a very, very different kind of response. So I'm heartbroken for Minnesota. Would this have happened if the driver and the passenger were white? I don't think it would have. So I'm forced to confront, and I think all of us in Minnesota are forced to confront, that this kind of racism exists. And that it's incumbent upon all of us to vow that we're going to do whatever we can to see that it doesn't happen. It doesn't continue to happen.
There you go again. That's the governor of Minnesota, you know, who called it racism. He came out of his mouth. You heard him. He called it racism. Racism. What these officers did. He said, do he believe if it had been white, it would have happened the same way? He said no. He don't believe the white man would have been shot and killed. Especially if that white man said, hey, I got a permit to carry. You feel me? These white devils, and they own every police force. They're hiding in every police department. And I believe in some cases, some of them don't even have to hide. Why? Because their fellow supervising officer, their fellow commanding officer, share the same mindset. Follow the same evil philosophies of white supremacy. The question is, what should we do? Okay, I'm gonna tell you what we should do. One of the greatest things that the white devil fear, one of the things that the white man fear the most, the greatest thing that the white man fear the most, I'm gonna tell you. It's not death. It's not even the loss of income. The greatest thing that the white devil fear the most, that sends chills up his spine, is black unity. Black unity. We have to learn to love each other. We have to learn to come together as a people. We got to change these house nigga thugs in our community to realize that a real gangster protects his community. A real gangster protects his and her community. A real gangster is not somebody that's so quick to kill his brother and run from the enemy. That's what cracks me up. They call it these Negroes call themselves hustlers, call themselves grinders, call themselves, you know, gangsters, but then they turn around and run from the enemy, and then when they go do time in the penitentiary, they want to talk about it like it's a badge of honor. How is it a badge of honor for the white devil to tell you when to wipe your ass, when to shower, when to sleep, and when to eat? And that's a badge of honor. That's idiocy. Again, how in the hell is an honor to do 3 years, 4 years, 5 years of a white devil telling you when to get up, when to sleep, when to eat, and when to wash your ass? And that's an honor when you get out. You want to talk about that? I did time. Nigga, you did stupid time. You wasted time, nigga. Wake up. If you're going to do some time because you was protecting your community from these white devils. You know, showing love for your brother, protecting your mother. That's what I'm talking about. You feel me? No, I'm not saying that we should go out and hurt anybody, just like the popos need to stop hurting the black community. But what I am saying is that we need to learn to love each other. We got to stop hurting one another and learn to love one another. These thugs who are selling drugs, these gangsters who are hustling and grinding, need to stop shooting and killing their fellow brother. The Bloods and the Crips need to realize that they are soldiers to protect the community, not soldiers to kill each other, because you don't own the ground you stand on. And most black folks don't even own the home they live in. We got to wake up, brothers and sisters. That's what I'm talking about. You feel me? And so on that note, let me also play. I got another, you know, matter of fact, let me read something right quick that I want to share. You know, they won't, like I say, they constantly trying to assassinate the character of Michael Xavier Johnson and assassinate the character of Brother Galvin Eugene Long. But look, these brothers already knew this, though. These brothers already, the Guardian, the newspaper or journalist called the Guardian. You can go check them out on the internet. They say they wrote in their paper, black men killed by U.S. police at the highest rate this year. This year, 1,134 deaths as of 2016. Somebody help me understand that. As of 2016, they killed 1,134 black men. That's not including children and women. We just talking about brothers. Of course, the number is much higher if you toss in the deaths of sisters that we know, like Sandra Bland, huh? And all the other sisters, that Rakita Boyd, all the other sisters that's been killed and assassinated and so-called accidental deaths in jail, and these white devils are getting away with it. You know, and it never ceases to amaze me. I want to say this again. The house niggas, house Negroes, I don't even want to call them niggas, house Negroes. A house niggers, that's what you call them, who are porch monkeys for white folks, who are the voice box speaking in the white people's ear to make them feel comfortable, because they ain't got an ounce of truth in their own heart and soul, and they definitely ain't got the webbles or the balls to speak the real, the raw and uncut truth and real to white people. So they appeal and appease white people emotionally. You know, like, you know, I'm a black person and I'm not against you. I feel you. I agree. These black people are just bad and all they want to do is cry and complain. House Negroes. They're all on Fox News and Fox TV. You can see them all the time on there. They even on CNN talking stupid and talking ignorant. It's sad. It's ridiculous. I got to give it up, though, to people like Killer Mike, who go across dropping the raw and uncut. I got to give it up to people like D.L. Yulee. Got to give it up to people like D.L. Yulee. As a matter of fact, let me play a little bit of Brother D.L. right now. You know, talking to this white man. Check this out.
It mattered to get up, get online, and start talking about this. Well, I don't think that these events are recent. I've watched them in Los Angeles, whether it be Rhyme Settles or Eula Love or Rodney King being brutalized on video. I think the only difference between then and now is the apparatus we use to view these from. Now, before it was video cameras and newspapers, and now it's camera phones. And ultimately, I think that this is something America is comfortable with. It can't keep you can't keep seeing a thing over and over again without being complicit in it in some way. This is allowed to happen because some people see that this is the way that things have to happen in order for people to maintain safety. There are people who see these things and go, it's a rough job, but they have to do it or none of us will be safe. It is hard to take knowing you have sons and nephews and daughters and wives and to watch them be brutalized. Like, we take the young man Castillo, who by accounts had a legal right to carry that weapon. Mm-hmm. He was pulled over by the police. He submitted to police authority. He was going to give them ID, and he was shot. Now, the interesting thing is, if he in fact did have the right to carry that weapon, where is the NRA? Where are the Second Amendment proponents? Where are the people who say, who should be angry right now? Because it's interesting that if people were looking for his criminal record, they'd have found that right away. But if the fact that this man was carrying a legally licensed firearm and was pulled over by the police in a state where you can legally carry, why wasn't the first question, why was it so aggressive from the beginning? It can't be unusual to find, just like Louisiana, you can carry a gun there. In Minnesota, you can carry a gun there. So finding people with guns, at police officers finding people with guns, can't be that unusual. Why is it handled one way for a man of color and then another way for other
people? Well, that's the big question that always comes up, no matter where this happens, no matter how it happens, is it a different set of rules? Do police, whether they're black or white, do they police people of color differently? The family this morning, the family this morning, DL, just for context, said the only thing our son was guilty of was being black at the wrong time and in the wrong place.
You know, the truth comes naked. I got to put on his pants. What is the dissenting? What is the biggest difference? Why is one treated one way? Even if we look at Alton Sterling, even if that man was guilty of that, what was the aggressive tactics? If he had a gun, why wasn't the question, are you within your legal rights to carry this gun, as opposed to shouting he has a gun? We are comfortable watching black men and black people be brutalized and brown people be brutalized, and a lot of people feel like this is the way things are and have to be. It is no different than people who like steak don't want to see the cow get slaughtered. Some people, why is it that when we'll see a video recording of somebody doing, of a suspect doing something, and then you'll hear prosecutors say, all the evidence is right here, we have everything we need. But when you see a police officer doing something on video, we don't know what happened. We don't know what precipitated this. We don't know what frame of mind he was in. The bottom line is there's a presumption of guilt on some people's part and a presumption of innocence on the other.
There you go. Brother Yuli broke it down. I got love for that brother. Any brother that stands up nationally and dropped the wrong uncut on these white devils, I got number love for him. He made a wonderful point. The bias and the prejudice of the way black people and white people are separately treated within the same ramifications, within the same situation, is very obvious. It's white supremacy at its finest. D.L. Yuli knows this. I don't know why white people just can't stand up. I just say, you know, white people are cowards within their own community. And I'm saying white people who say they're not prejudiced. I'm saying white people who believe they're not prejudiced. I'm talking about very white people who might not even be prejudiced, but like I say, by association, you are, what makes you any different than them? By association, when you sit back and you say nothing, when you sit back and you do nothing, when you sit back and keep your mouth shut because you don't want to get in it because your name is Bennett, then you know what? Then you are guilty by association. That's what I'm talking about. If anybody drives a car and their friend say, hey man, take me to the store, I need to get me a soda, and your friend go in that store and rob that store, get back in the car with you, and you take that friend home and drop him off, the police gonna say you was an accessory. So why are our cops and white people, why aren't you guys considered accessories? I think they are. I think white folks are an accessory. An accessory to what? You're an accessory to the crime against black humanity. You're an accessory to white, to the crime of white supremacy by association and by permitting and allowing it and keeping your mouth shut. Raw and uncut, just like that, here on the Black Village Community Podcast. And you can catch me here every Sunday, every Black Delicious Sunday, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut here on the Black Village Community Podcast. And let me also tell the black community, go check out Mystic Roots, the store that drops nothing but the raw and uncut when it comes to gifts and black products and natural cosmetics and black clothes and black gifts that for your people. You feel me? Go check out Mystic Roots at www.mysticroots.yourafricanmarket.com. Again, that's Mystic Roots, MysticRootz. MysticRootz.yourafricanmarket.com. Check that out. You hear me? You feel me? Here at the Black Village Community Podcast. And you know what? I will be back, and I will be black every Black Sunday. You know what, though? Before I go, you know, I gotta play this by, you know, the brother who shot three cops in Louisiana, in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, brother Galvin Eugene Long. That brother was conscious. He, like I said, you know, that not only was he conscious, he was a decorated soldier. You feel me? Like brother Dr. Boy said, he was a hero when he was out there shooting and killing people for the military in the name of America. But then when he come back home and see what they doing to his people and he protect his community, now he's a delusional, crazed man. I don't think so. That brother is not delusional. He wasn't crazy. You feel me? He was taught to be an assassin. He was taught to be a protector. He was taught to be a soldier. And that's how he went out. You feel me? So I want to play this right quick before we go by brother Galvin Long from his YouTube channel. So here, check this out.
Peace, family. What up with y'all? I'm in Dallas right now in the streets, you know, on my book tour, on another book tour, giving the knowledge out to my people. And I had already decided that I was coming to Dallas before the even, you know, police shooting already happened. So I was already decided. So I don't know. I guess it's just, you know, the spiritual was just telling me it was the right place to come before. But before the police shooting occurred, I had already made the decision to be here. But yeah, right now I'm in these streets, and I just want to speak on the events that's going on right now and just some of the principles that I've already spoken about, and I'm going to relate them to right now what's going on. First, I want to let you guys look, you got to really look at certain things, because say for instance the holiday that just passed, Independence Day is really based on, say, George Washington and the Americans fighting against their oppressor, Britain, and we celebrate that. We tell them they're right. You get it? But when an African fights back, it's wrong. But every time a European fights back against his oppressor, he's right. But soon as an African tries to fight back, why is that? So we got to start questioning our mindset. Are our thoughts our own thoughts? Because it doesn't even make sense, the shit we're thinking about. You feel me? You got to really question your thoughts, because you're saying one person is right, but then you're saying another person is wrong for doing the same exact fucking thing. In fact, we celebrate it and make holidays about it. It doesn't make sense. Question your thoughts. Question everything you are thinking. I'm telling you this because sometimes people out here are programmed and they're not questioning anything. All right? That's why I tell you, be curious. Curiosity. Stay a child. You get what I'm saying? See, the children, I'm out in these streets, children is like, yeah, I agree with you. Because the children still got that curiosity. They didn't beat it out of them yet, you see? That's why I love the kids, and that's why I'm still a motherfucking kid. I'm a die a kid. I'm not growing up. I'm keeping my own mind, my own logic, right here. Mm-mm. You're not going to tell me that this water is wet and it's okay. And then when this water gets wet, then you say it's not okay. No. Is it going to be wet across the board? And look, Let's just go with the numbers. Let's go with the history. 100% of revolutions, of victims fighting their oppressors, from victims fighting their bullies, 100% have been successful through fighting back, through bloodshed. Zero have been successful just over simply protesting. It has never worked and it never will. You gotta fight back. That's the only way a bully knows to quit. He doesn't know words. He can't understand words, I promise you. He doesn't understand protest. If y'all want to keep protesting, do that. But for the serious ones, the real ones, the alpha ones, we know what it's going to take. It's only fighting back or money. That's all they care about. Revenue and blood. Revenue and blood. Revenue and blood. Nothing else. Don't even think about it.
There you go. That's Brother Galvin Eugene Long. The brother who took out two white, well, not three. They were not even white. One of them was a brother. One of the cops that he killed in Baton Rouge was a brother. But yeah, just because you got black skin don't mean you got a black mind. You feel me? And so and we know everybody who got any common sense, anybody who has any ounce of knowledge in their head know that the majority, I'm not going to say all, but I will say the majority of these black cops are house Negroes. Majority of my house Negroes, they go along with the flow. They uphold the blue shield of silence. They keep their mouth shut. They don't say nothing. They see they fellow officer break the law, very law he's supposed to uphold. They act like they don't see it. They act like they don't hear it. They hear their fellow officers making racist remarks about black people and brown people and Chinese people. They don't hear nothing. They don't hear nothing. Like a good old porch monkey. Like a good old coon. Keep that job. Got to pay that house note. I ain't got time to be losing my job because I know all these white folks hold all the important positions and they'll fire me. Looking for a reason. So, I mean, let me shut up. What the hell you put that badge on for, Negro? What the hell you go through the academy for? Oh, the dude, I'm doing my job. No, you not. How you doing your job? Because if the next civilian on the street say and do the exact same thing your fellow officer is doing, you're gonna lock them up. No, you a house Negro. You are house Negro for the white devil. So on that note, I'm already at an end on my show. I will be back. I will be black. Brother Currington, you got any last words, brother, to say about what I've been playing and what I've been saying?
Yeah, well, I think that thing for people to get out of what these two brothers have done was to give an example of putting your life on the line and losing your life for the cause. I think what they have done is really undermined, underlooked, and it's not given the proper recognition that it should have.
I would have to agree with that. I would have to agree with that. I mean, listening to that,
their example.
What listening to that little bit of audio I played of Brother Galvin Long, where he talked about, he said, the alphas understand. He understood that not everybody is a soldier. But those who are soldiers that are in the movement understand that sometimes you got to do what you got to do. You feel me? Now, again.
But see, here's the thing. Okay. Now, I've heard a lot of people talk about them being soldiers. Okay. But in all my years of hearing this, this is the first time that are examples of a soldier setting his life on the line for the cause. A soldier giving his life for the cause. Now, there's a lot of people who their life might be out there, so to speak, but these brothers did an act that, even though it has this negative point, but the greater point is, you know, people will get fed up. You need to recognize that and bring about a change within your thought so these things wouldn't happen.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I agree. I totally agree. And
I'm telling you, people are not really looking at this for really what it is.
No, they're not. I have to agree with that. You know, and you know what? The media, along with politicians, they cultivate that. They cultivate that attitude and that mentality to give these brothers a bad name, not ignoring the fact of why they did what they did, their motive and their intention and their reasoning of why they did what they did, as if that does not exist. And that's all for the purpose of cultivating a mindset of siding with white supremacy and going with the flow. You feel me? Like the audio cast I just played by Brother Galvin Long, where he just said that, you know, have your own mind, question everything. Black people are still not learning to question everything, you know, because in this society in which we live in, and especially the military, you just do what you told. Do what you told. No, it don't work like that. I'm a grown ass man. I'm asking you why. You feel me? And so, you know, you're right, man. You know, these brothers got to be continue to be remembered, and it got to be shared the truth about why they did what they did. They laid their lives down for the community to send a message to law enforcement, to send a message to white supremacy that, look, you're not going to just keep messing over us and ain't nothing going to happen to you. You know, and in the short of it, that's what they were saying. You're not gonna just keep messing over my people, and nothing is gonna be done. You feel me? And so, but see, look, as I said, let me also, you know, continue and end on the message that I want to send as well. See, the greatest fear that black people have is black people unifying. See, now, you know, of course they fear people like Brother Galvin Long and Micah Johnson. Of course they fear people like that, okay? Like those brothers, those soldiers. But to unify, you can have a whole, if we unified as a people, if we had a love and a loyalty to one another in our communities, we have an army of Micahs and an army of Brother Galvin Longs. That's why they fear black unity. Do you feel me, my brother?
That statement that you made about fearing, could you repeat that again?
If we have a couple of martyrs here and there, a couple of martyrs, like, you know, we just, you know, there were two soldiers who laid their lives down for the cause. I don't believe that they fear that. They don't fear that, okay? They're the greatest.
Who don't fear?
The white community, white supremacy, law enforcement. They don't fear that. What they really fear happening, and this is the reason why they make sure they keep feeding house niggas. They keep feeding the cycle of house niggerism. They really fear black unity, because black unity can bring an army of Micah Xavier Johnson, an army of Galvin Eugene Long. You feel me? Now do you hear what I'm saying?
Right.
See, black unity can create a wall, an impenetrable wall around the black community. And when I say an impenetrable wall, I'm not literally talking about a wall, a brick wall or around the black community. I'm talking about a wall to protect our psyche, our psychological mindset. Because enslavement starts in the mind. Enslavement starts in the mind. If you physically enslave somebody and their mind is still free, they're just going to try to keep getting out of slavery. But if they take your mind, you're going to be comfortable right there in that enslavement and not even know that you're enslaved. I think that was Harriet Tubman said that she freed thousands of black people, but she could have freed thousands more if they knew they were enslaved. You feel me? So on that note, and you know, we never expired more than our expected time, my brother. But as I said, I will be back. I will be black every Black Sunday, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut here on the Black Village Community Podcast. This is yours truly, JC, a.k.a. Afro Black. And I thank my brother for joining me. Brother Currington, any last words, Brother Currington? I appreciate you joining me at the Conscious Table of Truth. Any last words?
Well, I just say those who are listening, open up your eyes as well as your ears. See and hear what's going on.
And I concur that. As always, I always say, may the great mother bring us together in the unity of her peace and love and knowledge. And as always, I love chicken, so love, peace, and chicken grease. We gotta go.
May 13th, the God Box.
I'm in the booth, bro. Give me 5 minutes.
The God Box.
David Banner.
Tell him. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
These crackers got drones, they fly in their saucers. Keep your white Jesus, don't pray to your crosses. They burning our churches, crip, pass me the Uzi. I know how to work it, I know how to squirt it. No Martin, no Luther, no King. No marching, no choirs, don't sing. The same Christian lovers that raped their grandmothers and hung our grandfathers from trees. They enemies, blood on the leaves, blood on the streets, blood on our feet. I'm sick of walking, sick of dogs getting sick on us. I'm barking, I'm sick of spitting written sentences. Listeners, don't get. Because they got chains on their brains, and that ain't no diss. Shout out to Tip.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist. Pump your black fist,
pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
I ain't African, I'm Ethiopian. Put them raw seeds in the fallopian. You can hope I win, I hope I lose. Bitch, long as we made it true, I hope again. I hope I get into heaven, I hope we forgiven. I hope Jesus, far as I know, look like Ned. Do I know when I see Florida heavens, them sevens, I weigh in them sixes. I'm staying religious, cause we stay in the trenches. And got to play with they liches, then came to my senses. I bet them crackers never came through my fences. You burn up your cross and I burn up your corpse. And I turn and bang and do the same to the witness. Hang them and dangle them the street looking up at his feet. So you never forget this, we did this for Martin and Malcolm. Even Mandela, Jimmy Lee Jackson and Omega Evers. For Clyde Kinnaird, hard labor slaving in the yard. For Huey, for Hampton, for Bobby, we got it. For Jordan Davis, we gon' play this. For Sandra Bland, we gon' stand. I'm still out of stomping. For Janaea Thompson from the coast of Compton, it's dope.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.